morning, everyone.
Good morning. Good morning.
Hi, and welcome to all of you here and those of you online. Thank you for joining us today for the last week of Easter, the seventh week of Easter. There are some announcements that I would like to make today. We have some amazing things going on as usual. Our soup kitchen is going to be on next week. And if you'd like to volunteer to help, please just let Geraldine Thomas know, and or give us a quick call or an email or just anything, or show up. It would be lovely if you could come. I think people usually go around 2 o'clock. Is that correct? Anyone? Yeah, 2. So if you show up around 2 o'clock, that would be wonderful. I did it one time, and I got to really work out my arm. I was sore the next day for a little while, but it's so much fun. It really is, and it's such a lovely thing to do on behalf of St. Mark's. Also, we have fun script, so it's fun script time once again. You'll notice in your bulletin this week that there is a little insert there, and so it has the date. So the deadline to order is June 12th. And the delivery date is set to be June 26th. If you'd like to order something, there are some order forms just over there. And then once you have that, please fill it in, and you can either hand it in at the office or give it to Daphne Wheeler. Also, it's plant sale time again. So this Saturday, from 9:30 to noon, we're having our plant sale in the parking lot, and of course, we're going to be giving away... June 11th. Not next week. I'm jumping ahead. Sorry. So June 11th, at 9:30 to noon, which is great, because now it doesn't conflict with the soup kitchen. And so if you can please see Sandra, she has some posters that we're just asking if you could please get the word out and hang these maybe on your mailboxes or close to the church so that people know what's going on. Also, if you have any plants that you can donate, or if you're a great maker or you like to make preserves, please let Sandra know, because we could always use more. It would be lovely, because she puts such an effort into this. She donated, 60, was it 40 plants or 60 plants?
60, yeah.
60 plants Sandra has been growing over the winter for the sale. So I'm going to be making some brownies for those who are dairy intolerant and gluten intolerant and diabetic. So it's a low glycemic coconut brownie, and it's out of this world. It's just made with honey and eggs and coconut, and there's one more ingredient, honey, lots and lots of honey. So if you have anything, please let Sandra know. You can donate also by bringing it into the office, and we can put it aside. So if you don't have the time and you can't line it up, Sandra, just bring it into the office and we'll keep it for her and let her know. I think those are the most important things for now. So that's it. So again, it is Easter 7, and our first hymn today is number 529, God My Hope On You Is Founded.
Okay.
brought her over a great deal of money through my fortune telling. While she followed us, she would cry out, "These men are slaves of the Most High God, who proclaimed to you a way of salvation." She kept doing this for many days. But Paul, very much annoyed, turned and said to the Spirit, "I order you, in the name of Jesus Christ, to come out of her." And it came out in that very hour. But when her owners saw that their hope of making money was gone, they seized Paul and Silas and dragged them into the marketplace before the authorities. When they had brought them before the magistrates, they said, "These men are disturbing us, our city. They're Jews and are advocating customs that are not lawful for us as Romans to adopt or observe." The crowd joined in attacking them, and the magistrates had them stripped of their clothing and ordered them to be beaten with rods. After they had given them a severe flogging, they threw them into prison and ordered the jailer to keep them securely. Following these instructions, he put them in the innermost cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. About midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was an earthquake so violent that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's chains were unfastened. When the jailer woke up and saw the prison doors wide open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself, since he supposed that the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted out in a loud voice, "Do not harm yourself, we are all here." The jailer called for lights, and rushing in, he fell down trembling before Paul and Silas. Then he brought them outside and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" They answered, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, you and your household." They spoke the word of the Lord to him and to all who were in his house. At the same hour of the night, he took them and washed their wounds. Then he and his entire family were baptized without delay. He brought them up into the house and set food before them. And he and his entire household rejoiced that he had become a believer in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm number 97, found on page 835 in the Book of Alternative Services. I shall look maybe odd number of verses and ask the congregation to do the even numbers. Psalm 97, page 835. The Lord is King. Let the earth rejoice. Let the multitude of the isles be glad.
Clouds and darkness are on the
God, your whole creation declares your glory. May we receive you in all your The second reading is a reading from the Revelation to John. See, I am coming soon. My reward is with me, to repay according to everyone's work. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they will have the right to the tree of life and may enter the city by the gates. It is I, Jesus, who sent my angel to you with this testimony for the churches. I am the root and descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let everyone who hears say, come. And let everyone who is thirsty come. Let anyone who wishes take the water of life as a gift. The one who testifies to these things says, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with all the saints. Amen. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our gradual hymn today is number 247. Hail the day that sees him rise. And we'll sing the first two verses before the gospel and the second verses, two verses after. Righteous Father, the world does not know I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made your name known to them, and I will make it known, so that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Great discussion, like I said, yesterday in the pouring rain. climax and culmination of what is known as the farewell discourse, or the high priestly prayer. In this scene, John has Jesus and the disciples, minus, of course, Judas Iscariot, in the room after the washing of the feet and the Last Supper. And here, in the longest recorded prayer of Jesus, he prays to the Father, asking that his disciples enjoy unity shared between the Father and himself. And he prays not only for those in the room with him, but also on behalf of those who believe in him through their word. The gospel reading from today speaks of a divine unity. And Jesus prays that his followers may be one as he and the Father are. Reflecting on Jesus' prayer gives us space to examine what divine unity looks like and what's worth uniting around. And this vision of unity is a powerful challenge. In our shared world today, it's easy to look around and spot disunity. It's easy to point to the world seemingly fracturing around us and see only the polarization, the inequality, and the asymmetry. One need only turn to the local or global news to be struck by that lack of unity among even Christians. The damage of division is all too well known on individual and institutional levels. Schisms and separations have become a painful part of the story of the global Anglican community these last decades. War and conflict have raged between groups of Christians. Where is the unity prayed for by Jesus? Have we as Christians simply failed to live out this unity imagined by Jesus' prayer? Throughout church history, humanity has seen glimpses of this divine unity. Stories are passed down of saints dwelling together in community that is not defined by tolerance or mere acceptance. To borrow a nautical metaphor, they row together in the same direction, overflowing with God's love. And from a theological perspective, divine unity is not uniformity nor sameness, but rather flows out of relationship with oneself, with others, and with creation. It's interesting to know that Jesus does not here command unity. This passage where he prays to the Father and follows discourse between him and his disciples in chapter 13 to 16. And in chapter 13 is when the commandment that he gives to his disciples is to love one another. And this is lived out in the story presented in Acts. And Paul and Silas have been thrown in jail for exercising a demon of division from a slave girl, abruptly cutting her off from her owner's source of income. And Paul and Silas are thus beaten and jailed. But then, the story does not become just about escape, but an inverted story of rescue. And Paul and Silas are singing hymns and praying into the night. And then suddenly, the scripture tells us, there's an earthquake. And miraculously, the doors fling open and the shackles break apart. But instead of fleeing out into the night, Paul and the other prisoners remain. And the jailer, about to kill himself, is stopped by Paul, who calls out, letting him know that the prisoners are still there. This grace that Paul and Silas show to the unnamed jailer is an act of invitational love. And Paul does not coerce or threaten the jailer into joining their team or converting to their beliefs. No. He responds with a natural grace and love. And from there, the jailer takes them to his home where they eat together and they rejoice, falling into this pattern of early Christian community painted throughout the rest of the book in Acts. God's unity is not coercive, but invitational. And in this story, disruptive love comes first. And only then does unity and community follow. Throughout history, unity has been manufactured by power through coercion, propaganda, and the elimination of dissidents. But the unity that is born from God's love is not about control, but about liberation. And the ending of this story of Paul and Silas stands in stark contrast to the story of Peter's jailbreak just a few chapters earlier in Acts 12. In that story, an angel led Peter out of prison, and Herod subsequently had the jailers executed. Here we see that God's redemption and liberation are not just for the prisoners, but indeed, the invitation extends even to the jailer. And the jailer's place in society is complicated, for he carries out the coercive violence of the state against the prisoners. But he is also subject to the violence of the state as seen in his hopelessness when he thinks the prisoners have escaped. On the one hand, he is the oppressor. And yet, on the other hand, he is simply caught up in a larger system of oppression. And this reflects the reality of the world around us. While it would be so much easier to cast each and every person as villain or hero, the world is more complex than this binary view. We see here that God's unity is not a top-down coercion, but emerges wherever it will. Through this passage starts off with the liberation of the clearly oppressed slave girl, and then the prisoners, even those who stand in for power, oppression, and coercion, are also included in the invitation of God's love. These passages from the lectionary and the broader scriptural context are clear that God's unity is grounded in love and in liberation. Divine unity is divinely other. In other words, the unity that is born from God's love and liberation is not human unity. It is transcendent. A divine unity rejects any and all coercive pictures of human oneness. Humans have leveraged tools like empire, invasion, colonization to force false unity upon others. Cult leaders have suppressed difference and dissent by molding followers into subordination. And nation states have waged propaganda and re-education campaigns to align their citizens to singular visions of power. The otherness of God's unity also means it is not born from consensus, from dialogue, or even democracy. While essential and vital tools for humans to gather and to move forward, too often a democratic majority can ignore the needs of the few. In the Divine unity is categorically different from these pictures. But that does not mean that Christians and churches are immune to these very human impulses for fracture, division, or control. The church has struggled with living out this divine unity for as long as the church has been around. And a huge percentage of the epistles are written because of human differences emerging within the church. Even Peter and Paul had their moments of bickering and disappointment. But there is no forcing of divine unity. Today's readings from John and Acts offers us an important lesson on unity. We must acknowledge that God's unity is not coercive. Unity is born of an invitation to love one another in a radical and sacrificial way. Divine unity is not born of a focus on who belongs and who doesn't. And Christians are not one for the sake of being one, but are united in love, a love for our God. And by creating a compelling invitation into a radically different and disruptive vision for humanity, the church lives out its ever-expecting love and call for love. The church is a place of disruptive love. And from this radically different orientation towards the world, each other, and ourselves, my friends, this is when divine unity emerges. Amen.
Prayers of the people today will be based on visiting number 15 for Easter. In joy and hope, let us pray to the source of all life, saying, "Hear us, Lord of glory."
Hear us, Lord of glory.
In our family prayer cycle, we pray today for Kevin and Lynn Bailey and family, with special prayers for families devastated by the terrible violence this week in Uvalde, Texas, and for leaders in the U.S. We pray for Bob Barnes and Thelma Lyson and family. We pray for Stephen and Daphne Bueller, with special prayers for Bruce, for Gail and Jordan as they prepare for the birth of their third child, and for Daphne's family as they prepare for her father's burial on June 9th. We also pray for Reverend Danny Hodge, our future incumbent, and her family as she prepares to join St. Mark's in July. And we pray that our risen Savior may fill us with the joy of his holy and life-giving resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
In our cycle of prayer for North End churches, we pray for Bethel Halifax, Pastor Art McDonald. We pray for isolated and persecuted churches that they may find fresh strength in the Easter Gospel. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes,
Lord. That God may grant us humility to be subject to one another in Christian love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
That he may provide for those who lack food, work, or shelter. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We pray again for the families of victims in Uvalde, Texas, and all affected by gun violence everywhere in the world. We pray to God that by his power, wars and famine may cease throughout all the earth. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We pray today for families and staff at Melville Gardens, Northwood Manor, the Berkeley and St. Vincent's, that they are safe and healthy. And we pray for those who are sick, for James, Sue, Philip, Joanne, Joel, Jamie, Jim, Carol, Roy, Betty, Trina, Rhonda, Doug, Tom, and Tanya. And for all those suffering from COVID-19 worldwide and their concerned families, that God may reveal the light of his presence to the sick, the weak, and the dying, that they may be comforted and strengthened. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We pray for all those whom we love but see no longer. We pray today especially for Ann Edwards, whose funeral was held here yesterday. And as we await Pentecost next Sunday, we pray that he may send the fire of the Holy Spirit upon his people, that we may bear faithful witness to his resurrection. Let us pray to the Lord.
Yes,
Lord. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors and ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Glory of your name. Amen.
Lamb, who has taken away the sin of the world. praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending pain. Nope, that was a different page. Unite us to your Son through the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. you.